This is Dr. Erdi Fadrigilan. I'm a cardiac electrophysiologist and welcome to my YouTube channel. This is the first of the series of Abnormal ECG, wherein I will talk about chamber enlargement. So without further ado, let's jump to the video. Now, let's go to the common ECG abnormalities. Please remember the normal variants, the normal measurements, because the deviations of those will produce the common ECG abnormality, namely abnormalities in the P wave, QRS, ST segment, and that of the T wave. Now, let's go to that of the left atrial and right atrial abnormality. As you will see in the terms, we don't use enlargement anymore, at least for the left and right atria, primarily because it has been shown that the ECG changes does not really or don't correlate well with that of the imaging techniques. Patient may present with abnormal left atrial abnormality changes, and yet the LA is actually normal, or the dimensions in the 2D echo, for example. Okay. So going back to that of the left atrial abnormality, it actually produces distinct changes in the leads where the P waves should be inspected. I would recommend lead 2 and V1 because these are the leads closest to that of the left and right atria. Now, for left atrial abnormality, this is how the P waves would look like. There's a prolonged P wave duration of more than 0.12, as obviously seen in this patient. There's prominent notching of the P wave, looks like an M. And if you measure the peaks of the two notches, it is separated by greater than 0.04 of a second, or one small square. Now, if you look at the ratio between that of the P wave and that of the PR interval, you know it already takes off nearly most of the PR interval. It is more than 1.6, which we call the McCrew index. Again, another finding in patients with left atrial abnormality. I told you before that in the normal ECG, the terminal part of the negative or the terminal part of the ECG in V1 is representative of that of left atrial depolarization. So in patients with left atrial abnormality, it becomes deeper, it becomes wider, which takes up most of the V1 morphology of the P wave. And there is a leftward shift of the mean P wave axis to between negative 30 and negative 45. Normally, we don't manually take it. We only take the QRS axis, but in the machine, you'd be able to see that. So that is, again, another criterion for us to be able to see left atrial abnormality. So once you see this in lead 2, and lead V1, we will have more examples later, then you read that as left atrial abnormality rather than left atrial enlargement. Okay. Now, the clinical significance of that, once you have a patient with that ECG findings, it is usually associated with more severe left ventricular disease in patients with heart failure, hypertension, or even ischemic heart disease. And in patients with severe left-sided valve diseases like the mitral valve or the aortic valve, and it portends more severe diseases and, of course, portends worse prognosis. Now, the right atrial abnormality will now be different because instead of making the P wave wider, it becomes taller. And again, look at lead 2 and lead V1. There's peaking of the P waves, which should normally be less than 2.5 squares. This time it is more than that. So this is P pulmonale or peak P wave in lead 2. And if you look at lead V1, it is the initial part of the P wave and the terminal part is normal. So this is right atrial abnormality. And if you look at the area under the curve or the area of the initial it's going to be high, which is greater than 0.06. And there's a rightward shift of the axis. Now, so this is seen in with severe pulmonary dysfunction, could also be seen in patients with atrial septal defect, could also be seen in patients with right ventricular abnormality, could also be seen in patients with pulmonary hypertension, like for example, because of pulmonary embolism. Now, in patients with chronic lung disease, presence of right atrial abnormality, again, similar to LAA, portends a worse severe or more severe disease and even predicts reduced survival in patients. Now, if you have a patient with biatrial abnormality, between meaning right and left, it's going to be a combination of those changes, meaning the P waves will be peaked, it will be wide, and in V1, it will be peaked and deep terminal, then that is right and left or biatrial abnormality. Now, when it comes to the ventricle, we have criteria as well, and they have been validated. They were made by different authors, and the more popular ones, those are the criteria that we will go to. So let's go to the left first. Left ventricular hypertrophy. This is the Sokolov-Lyon voltages criteria, which is looking at V1, measuring the S, how deep the S is, and you add how tall the R in V5. If it's more than 3.5 millivolts or 3.5 centimeters or 35 millimeters or 35 small squares, then that is LVH. Or if you look at AVL and the R is more than 11 millimeters or 1.1 millivolt or 11 small squares, then that is voltage criteria based on Sokolov-Lyon voltages. Now, the second one, which I recommend as well, because this is more sensitive to sexes, will be the Cornell voltage criteria. This one is looking at V3 and AVL. If it's more than 2.8 in men, then it's going to be LVH by the Cornell voltage criteria, or more than 2 in women will be LVH by voltage, by Cornell voltage criteria. You will see that they actually look into the depth or the negativity in the opposite lead and positivity in the lead, which is closest to that of the left ventricle. So this is an example. If you measure the Sokolov-Lyon voltages, which is measuring S in V1 and add it up to the R amplitude in V5, it is more than 3.5 millivolts or 35. And if you look at AVL, it is around 13 small squares or 1.3 millivolt. So that would be fulfilling the criteria for the Sokolov-Lyon. What else do you notice? If you go to the P wave, you see that it is wide and notched, and the terminal portion is prominent, left atrial abnormality, LVH by voltage criteria. Now, if you use the Cornell voltages, you measure S in V3 and add it up to the R in AVL, it is 2.8, and the cutoff for a male is actually 2.6. So in either criteria, this ECG, left ventricular hypertrophy by voltage criteria. So what will be the significance of that? In patients with cardiac disease, the ECG findings of LVH actually correlates with more severe disease in patients who have hypertension, greater dysfunction in patients with heart failure, and ischemic heart disease. It actually identifies a subset of the general population at significantly increased risk for cardiovascular morbidity and mortality. Meaning if a patient has LVH, though asymptomatic, may actually be at risk for complications later on. And the relative risk is quite significant if it's 2.8, in fact, 2 to 3 alone. And if you have ST segment abnormalities with that, which I will go to later, it could rise up to 5-fold increase in the relative risk. Fortunately, when we treat patients, and you can use this one with hypertension, with the regression of the LVH, the changes in the LV ECG changes would also regress. Meaning that's why in the ECG, as opposed to that of the atrial abnormality, if we have this criteria, we actually say it's hypertrophy or enlargement already, because it's more correlating with the imaging compared to that of the changes in the P wave. Now, I want you to appreciate this one, because for some, like for example, in young individuals, like, for example, less than 35 years of age, we perform an ECG on them. Then we see LVH. Sometimes we just discard it as a normal variant because we think that their chest wall is actually thin. But there is a caution in that because in this trial, they have shown that although sensitivity is quite low, the findings of a left LVH by those criteria in younger individuals with no apparent heart disease is quite specific at 88 to 98%. So we are recommended that if you see that in young patients, like for example, maybe pre-employment clearance, pre-participation screening for sports, and you see LVH in the ECG, please request for another imaging techniques like a 2D echo to basically look into that closer primarily and don't discard it right away as a normal variant. We know that in younger individuals, there's such a condition as hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, which is the most common cause of sudden death in young athletic individuals. So please be aware of those. Now, right ventricular hypertrophy would have less clear criteria, primarily because the right ventricles are smaller compared to that of the left ventricle. But once we see this, we have a tall R in V1. We know that in the normal ECG, the R in V1 is quite small, and it goes higher in amplitude as we go in from V1 to V6. That is normal. But if you have the reverse, like, for example, you have tall R in V1, it becomes smaller as it goes to that of the V6, then that is suggestive of right ventricular hypertrophy. A deep Q and a big R in V1 is suggestive of RVH. A tall R and a deep S in V1 with the R greater than 0.5 millivolts, suggestive of RVH. And if the S is deep in V6, then that is also suggestive of RVH, or the ratio between the R and the S is less than 1, then that is suggestive of RVH, meaning that the positivity of the R is less than the negativity of the S wave. There is right axis deviation, and these patterns are seen: presence of S in 1 and Q in 3, or presence of deep S in 1, 2, and lead 3 pattern, and presence of P pulmonale or peaking of the P wave. So this is a patient with RVH, a female patient. You will see here that V1, it has a QR pattern, but the R is tall at 0.7 millivolts, more than 7 millimeters. And there is, if you look at V6, R is not as deep as the V6. S is actually deeper rather than the tallness of the R. And there is right axis deviation. Right axis deviation means positive in AVF and negative in V1. And there is prominent S lead 1 and prominent Q in lead 3. Okay, so those are the changes that would suggest right ventricular hypertrophy. So what is the clinical significance of a right ventricular hypertrophy? It is usually seen in patients with pulmonary disease. I'm sure you're aware of corpulmonale, which is heart disease because of a lung problem, because of the pulmonary changes. And similar to the other changes or hypertrophy, RVH is associated with more severe pulmonary dysfunction, as well as significantly reduced survival. In fact, we sometimes see these changes in patients with acute massive pulmonary embolism, which we know is quite fatal.
Thank you for watching the video. And if you like similar contents, please consider subscribing to my channel, like and share the video, and hit the notification bell so you will get updated.